Hey, welcome along. My guest today is one of the most perceptive observers of events on both sides of the Atlantic. A couple of years ago, he wrote a splendid book that you should read called Reflections on the Revolution in Europe, Islam, Immigration, and the West. Christopher Caldwell is with us. And I should say, not to disparage Christopher or anything, but I noticed when the book came out, there was a rather curious review by an Irish blogger concluding with, let's face it, Christopher Caldwell is the thinking man's Mark Steyn, which I thought was rather insulting to me, but as I think about it, is perhaps actually more insulting to Christopher. So it's a great honour for the unthinking man's Mark Steyn to talk to the thinking man's Mark Steyn.
Well, I thought you were the thinking man's Mark Steyn. Yeah, right.
Well, Christopher, the book, obviously the title is an allusion to Edmund Burke and the famous pamphlet he published in London after the French Revolution. What's the context in which you're evoking that title here?
A very practical one. I'm a big fan of Burke's. I'm a big, I would say that, you know, I would like to think that I'm conservative in the way he is, which is to say, you know, conservative by temperament, but not necessarily conservative on every political issue. I mean, I don't think Burke even called himself a conservative, but the actual reason for calling it that was much more practical. And it was done in consultation with my agent, who said that it would be nice if you had a way of signaling that this was a conservative book,
right.
But not in a way as to shut off a possible liberal audience. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
So
right.
I think, and I think that it served that purpose. I think it is a good description of the book. But it didn't commit me to any sort of dug-in political program or anything. So I think that it allowed me to be very objective about the situation there.
Now, Reflections on the Revolution in France, when Burke wrote it, he was writing in the immediate aftermath of a revolution. The revolution in Europe, in a sense, has not yet occurred, but your point is that what's going on there is as consequential as what Burke was writing.
Yes,
about.
I would say it would be metaphorical. I mean, revolutions are always metaphorical, but I would call it a demographic revolution. In the English edition of the book, the subtitle was, Can You Have the Same Europe with Different People?
Right.
Right. Right. And I guess that's the sense in which I meant revolution.
Right, right. Now, that's a fascinating question. Six, 7 years on, we've had a very turbulent year in continental Europe, whether you're talking about Angela Merkel's open door to so-called refugees, whether you're talking about the Nice truck bomb, Brussels airport bombing, and a thousand lesser incidents every day of the week. Where do you feel we are on this subject 6 or 7 years on?
Well, I think we've reached a point where they're all turbulent years now. And I think we're coming to see that a lot of the values, a lot of the liberal values of Europe, while they are admirable if they can be defended,
right.
really can only be defended if you have a broad consensus for them. And that gets eroded when you have a large population of newcomers with different views of the world. I mean, those views of the world that the newcomers have are perfectly legitimate in their contexts. It's just you won't have a robust defense of European-style liberalism if you have a large influx of new people.
One of the issues that comes up whenever, or used to come up, I think it's actually slightly different now, but a decade ago, when people used to write about Islam and Europe, you used to get these rather pedantic responses saying, oh, well, you know, it's so easy to make these simplified generalizations. Obviously, a Pakistani emigrating to the imperial mother country and living in Yorkshire is completely different from an Iraqi who happens to go to Sweden, which has never been an imperialist power, or a Turkish guest worker who happens to go to Germany is obviously different from a Moroccan who settles in France. You made a superb and brilliant point in response to that, which I think was the last word on that.
Oh, I did.
Yes, you did.
Well, then I'd love to know what it was.
Well, you said it doesn't really matter whether the European country is an imperialist, or whether it's never gone anywhere or done anything, or whether it's importing its former colonial subjects or just random strangers from the fringes. Once you know how an Islamic community is in one corner of the continent, you can pretty much guess how it's going to go.
Absolutely right. Hmm. And you know, you could draw a parallel with the United States immigration. If you consider that, you know, once the government, I mean, people here used to say there's no such thing as a Hispanic. I mean, you look at a Mexican cowboy is not the same thing as an Argentine psychoanalyst, right? But you know, you get here and you know, you have affirmative action programs for Hispanics. You have Spanish language media for Hispanics. You have a job market that hires a Hispanic outreach vice president and things. So eventually these people do come together into a sort of a common identity as Hispanic Americans. Right. And if you have and that's in a relatively harmonious and tranquil immigrant situation. If you have a situation in, like you have in Europe, where, you know, you have the context of a larger global conflict, and you have a lot of animosity from the public, and then you have things like, a referendum in Switzerland to ban the building of minarets and suggestions about banning the burqa, that tends to bond Muslims together into a common identity. I mean, because the question is being asked, do you want more Islam or less? And that's not a question that democracies are capable of answering with sort of very fine degrees of distinction.
Right, and in a sense, they're incentivized to adopt a Muslim identity. I wondered if there's also a demographic element to that too. That if you take a first generation immigrant who comes from Lahore to Scotland in 1952. In a sense, he thinks of himself as somebody from the Indian subcontinent. That's where he grew up. He's got an identity that's located in the part of the world where his parents raised him. By the time you get to the grandchildren, they've got no real experience of living in those countries or communities, and what they do have that binds them is just Islam distilled to its essence.
Yeah, I think that you see a lot of that anecdotally when you talk to people, and I'm sure you've experienced this in Europe too. When you talk to people who know radicalized youth, you very often hear that they came to despise their parents' traditional kind of Islam, which would be the kind of Islam that they practiced in the village back in Pakistan, and they preferred something that was much more ideological and I don't know, theologically purist, you know. So yes, you do get a different thing, but I mean, but it's not just a religious change that happens too. We have we've had a shift in the kind of economy that we have, so that when those people came from Lahore in the 1950s, they generally came to take dead-end jobs.
Yeah.
I mean, the kind of jobs that Europeans wouldn't take, because in many cases they were about to be eliminated.
Yeah.
But they were in a pretty open in a workforce that had rungs at every level. The younger generation of children of immigrants are in this highly polarized workforce, where there aren't many rungs between the very rich and the very poor. So they're sort of stalled out at this level that might have been satisfactory for a recent immigrant, but is not for a bright person who has, you know, plans for advancement.
What's changed in that? Because when you make that point to, say, a French person, I've heard this from a couple of dozen French friends, and they say, oh, I'm so tired of reading Americans and Englishmen talking about this economic ghetto they're trapped in. In the 50s and 60s, the Portuguese and Spaniards were all warehoused in those ugly banlieues, and they all worked their way out of them. So don't give me that. What's changed since then?
You know, there's a really beautiful book by a French sociologist named Christophe Guillouis, in which he addresses exactly this problem. And he is an expert in urban housing in the north of Paris. Right. And one thing he showed is that the global economy has exercised this enormous sorting function on all advanced economies. Right. And so Paris now is certainly richer and more cultured and more just amenable to every form of civilized comfort than it has ever been. It has become the brains of the global economy, and everyone is a millionaire. What you don't have anymore in Paris is a middle class. What you have a class of people who are there to serve this upper class. This is Guillouis' thesis, and so the public housing stocks in Paris and in cities like it has been kind of repurposed. Right. It's all immigrant. It's all immigrant lodging. Right. So basically these are worlds of their own in a way that they were not, 40 or 50 years ago. They're a different kind of lodging than they used to be.
Is the United States headed that same way?
I don't think so, because we don't have the same, you know. Public housing is for, I think, for the most part, for the non-working poor. Yeah. But maybe I'm mistaken. I mean, I think that, you know, public housing tends to be for citizens as well.
Well, I meant in the sense that we're bifurcating, if you like. There's a group at the top that is living better than it ever had done. And then there are people in America, which is a new thing in the United States, who are downwardly mobile.
Yeah.
whose parents and grandparents led comfortable lives doing well-paid blue-collar jobs on a high school education. They could live in a nice three-bedroom house and a good-sized lot in a non-dangerous part of town. Mm-hmm. And now their children and grandchildren do lousy service jobs for cheap wages at the quickie crap, or other forms of work that are essentially servicing the elite. I mean, it's not as bad as France and other European countries, but isn't it trending the same way?
Totally. And I'm not even sure it's not as bad. Mm. This is a problem with the global economy, which I think was addressed in the last American election. I mean, I think that that's what the core of what that the election was about is exactly that problem.
Right. Right. And now you made a very, another excellent point in the book, because the argument that people who are pro-immigration make, it's essentially the Wall Street Journal argument, it's the argument of all those who are in favor, who think that mass immigration from the developing world to the developed world is now a permanent feature of life, that they make the economic argument. Mm-hmm. And you quote some fella in the book, I can't even remember what the number is, but it's like the net benefit of immigration to all the OECD nations is equivalent to point whatever it is 003 in economic. Yeah. I forget what the number is in economic.
It is
growth.
A fraction of a percentage point. Yeah. That's the consensus view. I think most, you know, it's funny. Since I wrote the book. Hmm. The Harvard economist George Borjas came out with a book called We Wanted Workers. Right. It came out a few months ago. I highly recommend it. But he said that as a basic matter of economic modeling, it's very straightforward what you expect when you have mass immigration. You will have an increase in GDP. But that increase in GDP will be split between two things. Part of it will go, well, all of that increase in GDP will go directly to the immigrants, okay? Right. So the GDP remains the same, but in that constant GDP, what you will see is a massive transfer of income from the poor to the rich among domestic participants in the economy. Yeah. And that is basically, that is just the default economic consensus, what used to be the consensus about what happens when you put mass immigration into an economy.
Right. Yeah. Right. So. And yet we are still told all the reassuring jingles about mass immigration. We need immigrants to come here to do the jobs that Americans won't do, and all the rest of it. It's very hard to get beyond that, isn't it?
Yes, it is. But because it now have had mass immigration for 40 years, and so the country is built on constant mass immigration. Right. So we have industries like all of these mid-level nationwide food chains. I mean, obviously, you know, fast food and medium fast food is a totally immigrant-dependent industry. Those industries cannot really exist in a non-mass migrant economy. So if you talk about stopping immigration, then you have to talk about, all right, then what's going to happen when there's upward pressure on wages, as there will undoubtedly be?
Right.
The prices on the menu at Applebee's and Chipotle and Starbucks, they all go up. And once you're paying, you know, $5 for a double espresso, does the country any longer want double espresso? So then you're talking about certain sectors of the economy disappearing and being replaced by non-mass immigration equivalents. And it's tough to tell what that will look like. So it places the fact that we've had immigration for so long, places the burden of proof on those who would want something else.
Well, when you put it in the American context like that, it sounds that there's a lot at stake, because you're basically saying, well, that'd be it for Taco Bell and Kentucky Fried Chicken, and people would have to learn how to be Aussie and Harriet again, and make family meals and eat at home in the evening, and they've forgotten how to do that.
Yes.
But in the European context, I wonder if there's even that argument to be made. In a sense, it's true that, you know, you see the pizza and kebab shops all over Germany and Scandinavia. Yeah. The great East meets West multicultural mélange. But for the most part, isn't it that the point you made in the book, that losing this tiny percentage of your economy would be a small price to pay for getting your country back?
That's right. Mm. That's right. And I think I made the point in reverse as well. Mm. If you really believe this stuff about multiculturalism and sort of like diversity is our strength and that kind of thing, then immigration would be worthwhile, even if it cost your country a lot of money.
Right.
So you don't hear either. It's interesting how conveniently the economic statistics back up the prejudices of whoever seems to be talking about it.
Yeah, the argument is constantly shifting, because initially it's, oh, we need people to work in the mills and be bus drivers, and then all the mills close and the bus routes shut down.
And then it's a moral duty.
Yeah.
Yeah, yes, that's right.
Yeah, yeah. And constantly shifting. And what's fascinating is that it's, in a sense, it's gone into overdrive in the last couple of years, basically thanks to Angela Merkel, who admitted 1.5 million mainly Muslim immigrants to Germany without any kind of vetting, set in motion a whole chain of events. Yet you still feel, notwithstanding Marine LePen in France or Geert Wilders in the Netherlands, or the Brexit vote, that actually talking about immigration in primal terms is still not really possible for Europeans.
Well, nor is it for us, really. I mean, I think that in Europe you have a version of what we are now seeing very clearly in the United States. Yeah. In the United States, you have a very interesting dichotomy now. Yeah. You have Donald Trump, who has, you know, who won the presidential election narrowly, but has wound up in a position where his party has the hands on more levers of legitimate political power than any conservative movement has in the United States since the 1920s.
Right.
They've got almost a monopoly, except for the Supreme Court, which seems to be changing.
Yeah.
They've got a kind of monopoly on the levers of legitimate power.
Right.
And yet they are totally shut out of the spheres of informal power. They have no foothold whatsoever in the culture. And so you have a battle between these two sides, okay? Where you have Trump can get elected, all sorts of people who feel like him get elected, but you can't get a single person to admit that that's what just happened.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Now, I think that's what's going on in Europe, too. I mean, so you have this sort of, there's this groundswell, and it keeps moving, and you have Brexit, which is, I think, an almost perfect analogy to what happened with Trump.
Yeah.
But you still cannot find many sort of, you know, thinkers you would be proud to bring up at a dinner party in Islington who are coming out and saying, yeah, you know what, all things considered, Brexit is a good idea.
Yeah, no. Well, the late Christopher Hitchens asked Tony Blair about some of yours and my demographic observations mm-hmm. about what happened in what's happening in Europe, which is basically that absent any course correction, these are going to be semi-Islamified polities rather quicker than we think. And Christopher Hitchens asked Tony Blair, he said, when you meet with your fellow European prime ministers, is this part of the European conversation? And bless him, Tony Blair replied, well, it's part of the subterranean conversation, by which he means we all know it's going on, but we can't mention it in polite society.
Yes.
At what point will it be permissible to mention it in polite society?
You know, I think there's been the belief for a long time that there's a fundamental conservatism somewhere in, you know, like an imaginary peasantry or working class in these countries, and that there was a limit to how far social experimentation could go, because once it went to a certain level, people would come out of the woodwork.
Right.
But in fact, the economy has been rearranged. These countries are now about 1 or 2% agricultural employment.
Right.
And those are multinational farming companies.
Yeah.
There is no peasantry, you know? And with deindustrialization, there is no working class.
Right.
So as a result, there is no woodwork. You know, there is no sort of like source of, I don't know, traditional, let's say, peasant conservatism.
Right.
So what you have is something else, which is just finding its voice. And we really don't know what it is. We don't know the sociological profile of the people who are coming out now and saying about immigration, enough is enough. We do know they feel badly done by. But I mean, this is an evolving public opinion. And it's quite natural that some people are thinking, all right, the nonsense is about to end. And other people are thinking, you know, we're about to go into some dangerous stuff.
Right, right.
Yeah.
I mean, I think you're correct. The idea that at some point the king looks out the window and says the peasants are revolting. And as you point out, there are no more peasants. There are groups that are finding what's going on in Europe a little bit uncomfortable. Women who go to these popular public swimming baths in Germany and in Scandinavia, the gay nightclubbers in Amsterdam who are reeling under a remorseless increase in gay bashing. There are communities, that fashionable communities to the left, that are affected by this. Yeah. I mean, is that where the pushback comes from?
Well, I don't think so. I just don't think that they're... I think that they have a problem that may be similar to that of the Democratic Party constituency in the United States for now, which is that they're just... The elites are not really big enough to push back against something like this. And I think that there's another there's another problem more generally on the level of society. I mean, I think that a lot of these liberal societies have been built on kind of neutral rules, that no, you know, that no one culture is any better than any other. Your traditional working class, you know, saying grace before dinner is really no better than, you know, people going out to a, you know, to a restaurant, and you know what I mean. And so you have these countries are kind of split between people who want tradition back and people who want these want to insist on these neutral rules that erode tradition. And I don't see them as forming a natural coalition against immigration. And that's why one of the reasons why they're so sort of frozen.
Now, there are differences within European countries. I mean, you use Europe as a term for the continent plus the British Isles.
Yeah.
And to someone from my cultural tradition, I don't really think of the United Kingdom or even Ireland as particularly European in that sense. But even within continental Europe, there's a big difference between, say, Finland, which was a semi-neutered Soviet quasi-satellite for a long time, and somewhere like France. There's a difference between Belgium and Italy. When you travel around Europe, are there differences that you see in both the people's attitude and their government's approach to
this
yes.
subject? And I think that the main difference is the constitutional template on which people form their expectations. And that's maybe the first strong sign I had that the European Union experiment was not really going to work. And that is, you know, the French have a problem with Islam in public, or you know, with a, you know, there was a book that came out 15 years ago about you know, Jewish children, Christian children being harassed in public schools in heavily Muslim areas. And so the French, they convened a committee, and the committee decided to ban headscarves, they were going to ban Stars of David, and they were going to ban wearing crosses around the neck. Well, that's an interesting thing in France, where, you know, what the state declares then becomes the culture and everyone adjusts to it.
Yeah.
But to someone from an Anglo-Saxon constitutional tradition, that is so preposterous.
Right.
I mean, so, and so it became clear when you saw things like that, that Europe could not be the level at which a real constitutional solution to this problem could be forged.
Well, you see that even within a single country. In Canada, Quebec airily declares that if you're wearing full Muslim covering, you can't receive government services in a Quebec government office. And English Canada, taking the traditional idea of English liberty to wear whatever the hell you want, reels back and goes, whoa, what's up with these Quebec guys dictating what people can wear when they walk into public buildings?
Yeah.
I mean, it is, in a sense, it's about Islam, but everybody's attitude to it, for all the multicultural merging of recent years, everyone goes back to their default setting on these issues.
It does. Maybe not so much within countries. I think that diversity is really decreasing greatly within nation states. But the difference between nation states, between, you know, say Britain and France, seems as great as ever. There are maybe some exceptions. You mentioned Ireland. You know, I would say that Ireland, maybe in the last 20 years or so, is becoming more of a European country. Largely, but for a slightly different reason. It's decided it wants to, its voters have decided they want to repudiate their Catholic past, which they consider theocratic, and they don't have a replacement ideology. So they've become sort of nothing. They've become a sort of like a European protectorate, you know?
Right, right, right. And it's odd because the English invested great thought into how you might de-Catholicize Ireland. And actually, if you just leave it to the guys themselves, they'll do it for you within 25 years.
Yeah,
it's a fascinating thing. And found Europe, as you say, as the only really replacement identity available on that level. You posed in the book's subtitle the basic question: can Europe be European without Europeans? In other words, is a nation, is a civilization, nothing more than whoever happens to be standing on its real estate at any one time? What's your answer to that?
Well, you know, it's a little bit of both. It is true that anyone can become an American, you know? I mean, that's certainly true of our constitutional tradition. It's also been proved true that anyone can become an Englishman or a Frenchman. However, if you have large introductions of populations with different ways, you're going to have it's going to take a great effort to talk them out of retaining those ways. And I think that while we've always talked about what a miracle of assimilation the American immigration system has been, we have also forgotten that American immigrants never changed their religion. I mean, there's been some drift in the last decade or two with evangelical groups and with intermarriage. But for the most part, you know, a century or two after they arrive, Americans have the religion of their great-great-great-great-grandmother. And I don't see any reason why that's going to be different in Europe. I mean, people talk about Muslims assimilating into Europe, and they might in the sense that they'll begin buying Adidas sneakers and eating, I don't know, and drinking beer perhaps. Yeah. They'll still be Muslims. You know, they will still think of themselves as Muslims. And you will have a continent that is, let's say, a considerable percentage Muslim. I mean, you know?
Yeah. My sense of German Muslims, who are mainly from Turkey, when you can sit in a bar and have a beer with a German Turkish Muslim, but he won't eat pork. Generally speaking, they regard pork as filthy, won't go there. But they do quite like a tipple of
Turks, I think, have always been that way. I think even in their home country, many of them. I mean, there's been a growth of sort of Erdogan-style fundamentalism. I mean, Erdogan has tried to ban alcohol in parts of Istanbul when he was mayor there. Right. But yes, for the most part, it is that kind of culture.
But it doesn't go further than a few surface adoptions. I mean, the guys who blew up the London Tube in 2005, they went whitewater rafting in Wales. If you looked at the photos they'd posted in the months before they went and they blew up their fellow British subjects, they would have looked perfectly assimilated. Yeah. They wore the same hideous British leisure wear, they liked the same crappy soccer teams. Yeah. I mean, they were assimilated, weren't they?
Yeah. Hmm? Yes. So, this is a big, it's a big mystery. I mean, what is the, you know, it has to do with the link between religion and identity. And people have always said that this is very deep, it's very mysterious. You mess around with it at your peril.
Right.
And we forgot that.
Yeah.
We
forgot
that religion was a really important thing.
Yeah.
And I think that, you know, at the time of maximum Muslim immigration when the whole thing got underway in the 1950s and the 60s, I think that the attitude in Europe was that religion was something that we were past now. And when they looked at the Muslim world, they looked at the big danger as being Arab nationalism.
Right.
Everyone, all of the threats from the Muslim world, whether they were the, you know, the Ba'athists in Iraq, or the Nasserites in Egypt, or the PLO in the Holy Land, they were secularists, nationalists. There was not this religious thing.
even with the Shah and the fall of the Shah in 1979, people thought the Ayatollah was just a bit of kind of Islamic window dressing on these French-educated
right.
Marxists.
That's right.
Who were going to be heading back to Tehran and would be the guys really running things.
Right.
Yeah. Yep. I mean, where are we going wrong? Is it a kind of post-imperial sentimentality that we think we were able to, Englishmen were able to go to the Indian subcontinent and raise generations of pseudo Englishmen to run a nation of a billion people? So what's the big deal about doing it in reverse and letting them into the UK? Is it a kind of Western condescension that makes us think this is possible?
It might be. It does seem like a rather different type of immigration, though. It's not it's not a basically commercial imperial immigration, but it's an immigration of settlement. It's a migration.
Right.
I mean, it was never the case that you had a place in India that was basically New Yorkshire. You know.
Right.
So
it's different from that point of view.
It's an immigration of settlement.
Yeah. Let's talk about it in an American context too. People say that in America, most of the immigration is from Latin America. So it's Hispanic, it's Catholic.
Yes.
What's the big deal?
Right.
We're in a much more blessed situation than Europeans are.
We certainly have been. I'm not sure that that's any longer true. I think in the last administration, the source of immigration shifted dramatically. And I think at this point, we now have fewer immigrants from Latin America than we do from Asia and Africa.
Right. So actually, there's a trend in Muslim immigration happening here.
A very strong one, yes.
Right. And again, the attitude often is, well, again, we're not like the Europeans. There's an American dream. There's no such thing as a Belgian dream. That's what those guys over there don't have. If there's an American dream, anyone can avail himself of it. So what's the problem?
Yeah. I mean, I would say two things. First of all, what's the American dream? The American dream is a slogan. I mean, this is a country with a culture and a constitution. Yeah. And, the American dream is a beautiful thing to talk about. I don't know how much concrete reality it has. Right. Or let me just say, I'm not sure it has more concrete reality than the corresponding, European worldviews.
Right.
I think there is a French dream. I think the people do. I mean, not every country is as open as France.
Right.
But I think the French really do pride themselves on the idea that you can take someone from a far corner of the earth and turn him into someone who's proud to be a descendant of Jean-Jacques Rousseau.
Right.
You know?
And they make their overseas territories fully integrated.
That's right.
French département, yeah. Which the UK doesn't do with its colonies.
Nor
I mean, it accepts the idea that the Turks and Caicos is different from Wales or Northern Ireland, whereas the French government says Martinique is exactly the same as the Haute Alpes or whatever.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Which again suggests that if you're a citizen of the French Republic, all things are possible to you.
Right. Yeah.
And where does then, does that still apply in the United States? That idea that anybody can grow up to be president, because again, my sense and part of what drove the Trump thing is that there's a kind of elite who marry each other. Charles Murray has written about this now. The dentist doesn't marry his secretary anymore. He marries another brilliant dental consultant or whatever, and that the elite marry among themselves. There's less social mobility.
Yeah.
So have we lost a bit of that?
A bit, but I mean, I think what you're talking about is two kinds of obstacle to social advancement,
right?
One is the obstacle of foreignness.
Right.
And I've always thought that the fact that Barack Obama had a foreign father and was brought up in Indonesia for part of his life, and then in Hawaii, was probably a bigger obstacle to his becoming president than his being black was, you know? So I mean, I think if Barack Obama can become president, then there's really no obstacle for a native-born person of very recent foreign vintage to becoming president. The situation you're talking about is one of class. Right. And so where the United States now has, maybe for the first time since the 19th century, a really rigid social system so that the match boy cannot get elected president.
Right.
I think that you're right. That is there do seem to be obstacles for the poor to rise. But if the situation gets really terribly bad, then you will have a democratic uprising and you will have a tribune of the people, you know, elevated to the presidency.
Harold Macmillan once made a rather, the former British Prime Minister, once made a, late in life, made a rather snooty and condescending remark about Mrs. Thatcher's cabinet, in that he said, in contrast to his own, it contained more Estonians than Etonians, meaning, you know, descendants of pushy Jews from the Baltic states who'd been to rather dingy minor public schools instead of, as in his day, being people who were cousins and first cousins and second cousins of his who'd been to the best schools. We basically now, since the end of the Reagan presidency, had rule by Harvard and Yale.
It's extraordinary. And
last November, enough people seemed to say the smartest minds in the country haven't actually worked out so well for us.
No, they haven't. And, you know, I think there are two ways you can see it. One is look at the economy. And, you know, everyone knows the great calculating power of the people who, you know, run the great investment banks in New York. They haven't done very well. Yeah. The other one is the Supreme Court. Yeah. I mean, every single person on the Supreme Court went to either Harvard or Yale. Yeah. And it has not produced a great blossoming in liberty. So I think that you're right. I think that that's a... Now, it will be interesting to see whether this whether that recognition sort of lowers the prestige of Harvard and Yale because they're not doing as good a job as they could, or raises it because it becomes obvious that you can actually fail your way even higher than people would have anticipated.
The credential, even if it's a meaningless credential, the credential gets you 90% of the way.
Right.
Let me just ask you as a final question, Christopher. It's a question I asked a lot of people in France, a lot of French friends last summer. I was in a little village where a woman and her daughters got stabbed by a Muslim guy staying in the holiday cottage next door who just kind of went bananas over the breakfast table one morning, stabbed them with the cutlery. They had to be airlifted to the hospital in Grenoble. I went to the funeral of the French priest who was decapitated during Mass, and I was somewhat stunned at the dishonest way that event was reported in the French papers. And at some point, you know, dining with friends afterwards in lovely Paris restaurants or beautiful restaurants on the Côte d'Azur late in the evening, I'd always say, you know, what's the happy ending here? Because my sense is that increasingly the French Prime Minister, whose view is that you should just get used to it, and the view of other European leaders is that this is just a permanent feature of life and that they have no idea what to do about it. What's the happy ending and how do you get
to it? In terms of social movements, there are no permanent features of life. I mean, people and peoples are always on the move. And this is a very... This is a Europe that is very weakened. Yeah. It's very weak demographically. They're not having a lot of children.
No.
For that reason, it's very weak economically because the immigrants who are replacing the next generation in the workforce are not, you know, have not been educated up to the level to add value.
Now, no.
That's theoretically possible, but it's not happening now. And finally, they're very weak in terms of creative power. They're not inventing a lot of things.
No.
So I think that it's by no means clear that Europe has the resources to come out on top of this. I don't predict the future. I'm just saying that all outcomes are envisionable.
Well, you're not a European Prime Minister, but when Angela Merkel says that these so-called Syrian so-called refugees are going to be working at building BMWs and Daimlers and all the rest of it, you know enough simply as a distant observer to figure that that's kind of unlikely to happen.
That's right. I mean, what is the market for Daimlers, and what are they going to say about this in Slovakia, which seems to do most of the labor for German car companies anyway?
Right, yeah. right. Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, it's always interesting to hear what you have to say on these things, Christopher. As I say, that book, Reflections on the Revolution in Europe, is an indispensable read if you haven't yet read it. And I hope we've demonstrated in the course of our conversation that he is more than just the thinking man's Mark Steyn, or even the unthinking man's Mark Steyn. And I know you're working on a new book about the situation here in America, too, and we'll look forward to that, Christopher.
Thank you very
much. That's great.
Yeah, thank you, Mark.
Thanks a lot, and we'll see you next time.